Representative Pashinski, I want to thank you for joining us and sitting down talking about a very important trend and issue we're seeing in Pennsylvania right now that you're really working to face head on. And this is the issue of grandparents raising grandchildren. It's been a growing trend in the country and in Pennsylvania. I want to start with a very large number here, that over 81,000 children in Pennsylvania are living in homes where the grandparents are the main source of parents in their house. People may not realize that out here in Pennsylvania.
I don't think most people realize it until, you know, you're actually faced with that situation. And we had an incredible hearing just several weeks ago where we had three perfect examples of folks in my district up in northeastern mm-hmm. Pennsylvania, you know, who are have assumed the responsibility, the care, the love of their grandchildren, because their own children, they're either the father or the mother of these grandchildren, you know, have some kind of addiction problem. And it was a heart-wrenching testimony by these grandparents. So what we're attempting to do now is begin to modify the laws to be appropriate for today's needs. When the laws were created, you know, many decades ago, relative to children that are part of a broken family, it was primarily based upon divorce, where even in a divorce, the parents would love and take care of those children, either together or separately. But here we have situations where the fathers or the mothers are drug addicted or alcohol addicted and are not capable. They're just simply not capable of taking care of these children. So the grandparents have stepped up to this incredible responsibility. And I don't know that everyone can appreciate that until you become a grandfather or a grandmother, which I am, mm-hmm. and proud to say. And our energy level to take care of children, you know, from infancy into the elementary and then now into, you know, their secondary as schooling, to deal with all the problems of adolescence, et cetera.
Sure, day-to-day issues.
Every single day is far beyond what most grandparents would have thought they've been doing. Mm-hmm. So folks that are planning for retirement are now having to change their lives to take care of these children. Some folks, many folks, do not have the financial wherewithal to be able to deal with the expenses. And the hearing provided several very vivid examples of demonstrating what is needed.
Mm-hmm. I want to stop you there because sure. I think this is a good time. You mentioned there were some heart-wrenching stories told at that hearing. You want to take a break and meet the Calamino family,
sure.
John and Tracy, who were at that hearing. Let's hear their story and we'll be right back.
We are, to her, mommy and daddy.
John and Tracy Calamino have been raising their granddaughter, Brooke, since birth. She was born drug addicted and suffers from separation anxiety when she's away from them. However, a day in the Calamino house is typical of anyone with a 4.5-year-old.
I get up, I try and get myself ready before she gets up. I wake her up, feed her, get her ready for school. It's rush, rush, rush.
We have her in a private school, but we still have several battles with the parents. The biological parents are still fighting with us for custody.
Right now, the Calaminos say their biggest struggle is with the legal system.
We need to give this child a permanent, secure home, and the law needs to, you know, get there to make sure she has that stability.
Their message to the courts is this.
You need to listen to the child. Somebody has to listen to the child's voice. A child can tell you what they want, but the child's voice is not being heard. We need to make changes there.
Well, right at the top of that piece, we heard Tracy say that to Brooke, they are mommy and daddy. And this illustrates perfectly your larger point that a lot of times grandparents are the relief for the parents. And now when they don't have anybody else for help, they are taking the role of grandparent and parents. While they wouldn't have it any other way, it sounds like, it's still a huge struggle and there's so many daily challenges that they're faced with now.
Yeah, and you're 100% correct. I mean, it's out of pure love and a sense of protection for those grandchildren. And obviously, Brooke is a gorgeous little girl. And I think you can demonstrate through your video that she's being very well taken care of by the Calamino family. And But I think what is happening here is the Calaminos are now reaching that age of retirement, and yet they are now, and I hesitate to use the word burden, but it's the responsibility now of taking care of that child. Fortunately, they have, you know, the financial wherewithal to be able to provide her with a quality home, food, clothing, and education. But the point is, even those folks now need other things. For example, we need to develop a navigator system. So when grandparents are placed into this position, they have a source by which they can go to and then guide them through all the various, navigate through the incredible system just to be able to take responsibility. And the laws actually, oppose the grandparents from the full responsibility of taking care of that child. So we talk about adoption, we talk about kinship programs, we talk about foster programs. All of these programs, you know, have to be reviewed to be designed now for grandparents so that they can easily or more easily navigate the complexities of the legal system, take care of their grandchildren, and not have a financial burden or a mental burden, you know, something that's going to create illness within their own selves in the process of taking care of these children. So a navigator system is one, a respite system is another, and then to have some financial help, because these folks that are taking care of these grandchildren are actually saving the state huge sums of money. If they weren't there, where would that child go? To a foster home.
Foster care.
And that costs X amount of dollars. So it's our charge right now to investigate this, to try to come up with proposals, legislation that will help address this particular issue.
Sure. Well, it sounds like you're exactly on the same page as one of the other testifiers that we met that day, Brenda Saba, who also brought her grandson Tanner with
Tanner,
her,
yeah.
Who she and her husband are also raising. Let's hear what she would help, what she would hope helps as far as access in the system.
More access for these kids who have been separated from their parents to the mental health community, more services available to them to deal with the trauma of loss of both parents, to deal with the grief that goes along with that, so that they can become healthier emotionally and we don't repeat the cycle. Another part of it is the change in the laws. We've been involved in the court system for 5 years involving him, and it just seems that the biological parents have many more rights and easier access to these children than we can, than should be, especially after this length of time. The other thing that needs to be addressed is, it's a wonderful thing that he can be provided health insurance coverage through the state, but there's not a lot of health care providers and mental health care providers that accept that insurance. So we find ourselves going outside of that and paying for it. It would be nice if there could be some changes made to that, so that there could be some reimbursements to us, and especially to those who are on a much more fixed income than my husband and I are. And lastly, respite care. Tanner's here with me today because today just happened to be a day when his school was closed for parent-teacher conferences. And even though we're 5 years into this journey, we still don't have a good support system where I could leave him with someone for a day to come down here and do this. So I had to bring him with me. So respite care and things like that are important. And I think it's important for them to be around other kids who are in their same situation. Tanner's been introduced to some other children so that he knows that he's not the only one who's in this situation.
We just heard the same laundry list from Brenda, the mental health issues, the respite care, the easing up on the court system as far as grandparents' rights, giving them more rights. So she shares the same concerns as so many other grandparents in your legislative district, other testifiers who were there. You're hearing the same thing over and over and over again, correct?
Absolutely. And that's why this hearing was so imperative to demonstrate firsthand. It's no longer some executive telling you something, you know, or some bureaucrat. We're talking about the people that are living in the trenches out of their pure love and responsibility to take care of their grandkids. So the mental health issues, we just saw, you know, Tanner, who is this vibrant young fellow, but again, he doesn't have his biological mom and dad, so as a result, you know, Brenda takes over and the Saba family takes over. So, you know, the point that I think has to be made here is simply that we must find ways to modify the system so that we can help these grandparents as they raise these grandchildren.
Right.
That's the imperative charge that we have
sure.
right now.
So as I go forward, we're going to review the law, see what's on the books already, see what needs updated. You know, and a lot of times it's hard to put a face to a lot of these pieces of legislation, but you've done that. You've done the first step. There's real life people out there who need this help, who need the laws to be on their side, to be updated. So we commend you for the work you've done
Thank you.
Look forward to talking in the future about the work you continue to do on this issue.
Well, we have a lot of work to do, but we are involved. We have our researchers on it, and we're working at it.
With that said, Representative Pashinski, thank you for joining us. It's surely
thank
been
you.
A pleasure.